Thank you. Throughout this season, we have lived, waited, and remembered the hope, peace, joy, and love of God found in Christ. Tonight, we gather together and light candles in honor of the Christ child.
With the birth of Christ, salvation has drawn near. The God who ordered the chaos of the universe has come down into the chaos of our world. The Word, which was with God at the beginning, came down and lived with us. While we were yet living in the valley of the shadow of death, the light of new life burst forth. We light this candle for Christ.
On this night, we remember God has come in the Christ child.
Lord of the universe, Savior of all, on this holy night we worship you for the blessing of your love and your sacrifice to redeem us. All praise and glory and honor to you, our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Rejoicing in your love, we praise you forevermore. Amen. Out of love, God searches us out to bring us his wholeness. We come now to confess our sins and receive his mercy and forgiveness. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for your love that calls us to come out of the darkness, that beckons us to come and receive life. We confess that we're not always open to you. We make no room for Christ in our lives. We keep our distance, thinking you might not need much of us. We fail in our love for you and in our love for one another. Forgive us, we pray. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to strengthen our desire to open our hearts to your love. Help us this night and every night to receive your forgiveness and to extend it to those who have hurt us. Hear us now in the silence of this time as we lift our personal confessions of sin to you. God has shown us the depth of his love in sending our Savior, Jesus Christ. He is always ready to receive us when we return to him, genuinely seeking his forgiveness and restoration. The good news of the gospel message is that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Rejoice. Amen.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this service of celebration of the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray that tonight you may experience the light and love of his presence, and that all of us would open our hearts more and more to the healing, restoring power of his love. So now, with joy and thanksgiving, let us come, offering to him our gifts and our lives. that's a perfect response, don't you think? We, yes. Let us now come before the Lord in prayer. O holy God, we marvel at the mystery of your love. You gave us your Son, Jesus Christ, the Lord of all creation, to be our Savior. We join our voices with the heavenly choir, singing your glory and your praise. On this night, we lift our prayers to you for the church, the world, and those in need. Lord, we pray for the church around the world as it celebrates the birth of Christ. By your Holy Spirit, make us one in our witness for you. Strengthen your church to do your work in the world. And Lord, we pray for those who live with conflict and violence every day. We ask that they may find their hope in the Savior and live in the peace of this holy night. Oh God, we pray for those who govern nations, that they may renounce personal quests for power and seek your wisdom instead. Loving Savior, Prince of Peace, bring your peace to our war-torn world. God, we pray for all who are cold, hungry, grieving, or alone this night. Embrace them with your tender care. We pray that you would meet their needs and assure them of your loving presence. We pray for those who are anxious, depressed, or ill. Comfort and strengthen them, O God, by your Holy Spirit. And we pray for all those who find this season a source of pain and grief. And we pray for all who are suffering or sick, especially those names we remember and carry in our hearts. Lord God, bring your peace, your comfort, and your healing power. And God, we pray for ourselves, that our hearts may always be open to your presence and to your love, that we may be transformed by the light and life of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We lift our prayers to you in the name of our Savior and Lord, praying as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, to all who believed in his name, he gave the power to become the children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of only a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law, indeed, was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart and who has made him known." Amen.
There's a story about an old Jewish man who would get up at the crack of dawn every day, and he would go to the Western Wall in Jerusalem. And he would pray fervently from morning to night. One day, a journalist from the London Times, who had seen him do this day after day, decided that maybe there was a story in the situation. So the journalist asked the man, "You come every day to the wall. How long have you done this? And what is it that you're praying for?" The man replied, "I have come here to pray every day for 25 years, and I pray for peace and reconciliation among the people of this land who are so divided by hate and conflict." Well, the journalist was amazed. "How does it make you feel to come here every day for 25 years and pray for these things when so much conflict remains?" And the man sadly said, "It feels like I'm talking to a wall." Don't you feel like that sometimes? We come here every Christmas. We're reminded of the message that the angel brings on the night of Jesus' birth: peace on earth and goodwill to all people. And yet, every year, it seems there is less and less peace. More and more places in our world, in our own nation, in our communities, there's such an outpouring of violence and hatred and war. Peace and goodwill seem impossible. And yet, into the impossible, God enters in. And he brings the unexpected. And he brings the true, and he brings something that does have the power to change the world. It has the power to transform human lives. Do you believe that a person can be changed? During these past weeks of Advent, we have been looking at various Christmas movies to help illustrate the major themes of Advent, the themes of hope, peace, joy, and love. Now, there are many beloved Christmas stories, but The one that seems to last generation after generation is the story by Dickens, A Christmas Carol. Now, many of us here might have seen what we think is the oldest version, the 1938 version, but apparently there are even earlier versions of it, even a silent version. I looked and found a list of 47 films that are based on the story of A Christmas Carol. I would imagine there are even more. As we all know, A Christmas Carol is the story of Ebenezer Scrooge. He's a miserly, mean-spirited old man. He is a terrible employer to his clerk, Bob Cratchit. He has no compassion at all on the poor or any who are disadvantaged. He won't part with a cent to help them. He's even crabby to his cheerful and long-suffering nephew who keeps asking him every year to come to Christmas dinner. But of course, Mr. Scrooge hates Christmas, and we all remember what he would say to anyone who wished him a Merry Christmas. Let me hear you say it. Bah, humbug! That's even better than the 4:30 service. Even his home is somewhat dark and bare. It's like just the barest things that you might need, a couple chairs, a table, and a bed. Nothing in his home to suggest any happiness. But people can change, and something happens to Ebenezer Scrooge on Christmas Eve, something that transforms his entire life. And we know that in the story, on Christmas Eve, Scrooge is visited by a series of ghosts. First is the ghost of his partner, deceased, Jacob Marley. And then the three that follow are the ghost of Christmas past, the ghost of Christmas present, and the ghost of Christmas yet to come. And each one of them has something to show to Mr. Scrooge. And through these experiences, he begins to see how his heart has been stony and cold and shut off, and how his mean spirit has affected the people around him. Now, I want to give an acknowledgement here to the Reverend Dr. Mark Roberts. He's a Presbyterian pastor, and he's a professor at Fuller Theological Seminary. He had a very interesting article noting the transformation process that Mr. Scrooge goes through. He says that this is how transformation often begins. Something will happen to interrupt our normal daily life. For many people, it's a tragedy. It might be a life-threatening illness. It might be marital conflict or a financial crisis. But it can also be something good, like getting married or having a child. But transformation often comes with pain. And along with that, a deep and profound realization that what you have been thinking, what you have been doing, and how you have been living are just wrong. For Mr. Scrooge, it was a series of things. It was the remembering the pain that he experienced as a lonely young boy, remembering the pain of his fiancée leaving him because he clearly loved money more than he loved her. And then Mr. Scrooge has his eyes opened to the suffering of men, women, and children because of poverty. He saw the contrast between his own stinginess and the joyful generosity of his former employer, Mr. Fezziwig. And then Scrooge finally saw that the path he had chosen for himself would eventually lead to a lonely death with no one to mourn him. So I want us to take a look at the first clip from this movie. It's when the spirit of things to come has taken him to a graveyard. And I want you to brace yourself. It starts off with a loud clap of thunder. So you might want to wake up the person next to you so that they're not too startled by it. Let's see that clip. He was shaken, shaken with fear and regret to see what his life choices brought about, to see what the outcome would be if he continued to live with his heart so closed. Well, finally and miraculously, Scrooge woke up to realize that it really was not too late. Let's now see the clip of Scrooge as a changed man. He was completely transformed. He became a kind and generous man, helping out the Cratchit family and consequently saving Tiny Tim's life. What is it that can transform a hard, stony heart? Well, at the core of all the things that happened to Mr. Scrooge, all the things that he remembers and realizes, there is one eternal shining light of what changed him, and that is love. The kind of love that God models, the kind of love that is compassionate and self-giving. When Scrooge went back to the past, he remembered the sweet love of his sister, Fran, and his master, Fezziwig, so joyously generous and loving. And Scrooge remembered the faithfulness of his fiancée. In the present, he was allowed to see the love that the Cratchit family had for one another in spite of their poverty. Scrooge realized how much he had lost because he had closed the door of his heart to love. But love is what finally got through to him and transformed him into a new person. Now, in spite of all the anger and hatred and violence and sadness and suffering that we see in the world, and in spite of whatever struggles and pain you might be experiencing in your whole own life, I want to tell you tonight that God is still in the business of transforming human lives with his love. And the key verses that express what God has done for us, the key verses out of the whole scripture are those well-known, beloved verses, John 3:16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. God loved the world so much that he came himself in the person of Jesus Christ to save us. And we know that Christmas story very well. A young Jewish woman named Mary was visited by an angel of the Lord and told that she would bear a son, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. She and her husband Joseph had to travel. Rome ordered a census, and so they made the long and difficult trip to Bethlehem while she was pregnant. And when they arrived, there were so many people in the city that they had to stay in a place where the animals slept and were fed. Jesus was born among the animals, laid in a manger, a feed box for cattle. And this is the story of God's love for the world. This is the story that transformed the world. And this is the story that can transform a human life. We heard John chapter 1 read earlier. It is traditionally held that the book of John was written by John, who was a disciple of Jesus. And John's story of Jesus' life includes many of the stories from the other books of the Bible that tell about the life of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But John's story of the life of Jesus is also different. He takes a much bigger look, a more comprehensive look at who Jesus is. Yes, Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Savior. He is the one that the Jewish people waited for centuries. He is the Savior of the world, but he is also God. He is God himself, the God who made the universe, the God whose power keeps the cosmos humming along. John writes, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." It's a mirror of Genesis chapter 1, the creation story. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. What John is saying here is that Jesus Christ was with God from the very beginning. He is God, and the world, the cosmos, everything in it, all these things were created through him. That's how big our God is. And yet he is deeply personal. He is a God who cares about each one of us, who loves each one of us. Later in one of his letters, John wrote that God is love, telling us that if you want to know what love looks like, look at God in the person of Jesus Christ. The God of creation, the God of the cosmos, loved all people so much that he came as a frail baby. He came as a human being so he could make a connection with us, so he could establish relationship with each one of us, so he could show us how much and how deeply we are loved. And of course, he came to save us. To save us from the darkness of death and to bring us life. Abundant life in the here and now and eternal life someday with him. John also wrote, "What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people." And here is probably my favorite verse this whole year. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. That's something to hang on to, friends, in our times that are so troubled, in our communities and in our nation and world that is so filled with conflict and hatred. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. The ultimate act of God's love is observed not at Christmas, but on Good Friday. Really, Christmas is what makes Good Friday possible, because God himself in Jesus Christ chooses to love us so much that he endures the cross. He endures the cross so that we might live. The light of the world overcame the darkness of death. He was resurrected on Easter Sunday. And the ultimate transformation for all of us is as we open our hearts more and more to God's love. And the truth is, we can all be Mr. Scrooge at times. We all close ourselves off to love and to other people. At times, we choose to stay in our own hurt or anger or unforgiveness. Mr. Scrooge really wasn't unusual, because we all have to be reminded that we are loved, and we have to be reminded often. And there are those people in our lives that seem to not be able to open their hearts to love. We all know people whose hearts seem to be hardened, stony, like Mr. Scrooge. It's easy to lose hope, but people can change. We can change. It begins with God, love himself coming in Jesus Christ to bring life and salvation and love to each one of us. And that, my friends, is how the world is changed. Amen. Standing for the candlelighting service as you are able. For that part of the service tonight, Carolyn and I will take our lighted candles down these side aisles, and as soon as we walk past your row, those sitting on the aisle light your candle. And then for the rest of you, when the person next to you has their candle lit, then you light yours. And so we will see the light go through to the middle and then on the sides out. And please remain standing and leave your lights on as we sing all the way through Silent Night.
Thank you.
Loving God, on this wondrous night, you sent your Son that we might know your love and know your salvation in him. As your angel proclaimed the good news of his birth, send us now as messengers of your hope, peace, joy, and love into the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, light of the world, we pray. Amen. Isaiah the prophet foretold the good news of the coming of Christ. He said, "The people who are walking in darkness have seen a great light." So, friends, I send you out now in the power and strength of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to hold forth the truth that his light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. I bless you as you go, in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.